We were actually going to have the last session here get closed out by good old Pat, but he had something come up, and it's kind of a bummer. I love hearing Pat. He'll pump you up, and you know, if you're not riled up by the time he's done talking, he'll get down and shake you and make sure you're riled up. And so love hearing from him, but he had something come up. It wasn't deer hunting, so don't judge him. It was family related. And so he couldn't be here, so I'm close us down with speaking on chapter 7 tonight, but I'm excited about it just because I've been, I was going through the book anyway, but then as soon as he, stepped away, I really dug in the last 3-4 days and just kind of been spending a lot of time on, the subject that we're going through. And chapter 7 talks a lot about its guts and grit and stepping out of the cage of fear. That's kind of what, the heart of what we're getting into in chapter 7. And really, it kind of summarizes the book as far as just, going for it, that whole, get up and go and, have courage and charge forward with what God's calling us to. And so I think inside of us, God has us wired, as men with a desire for, we like guts and grit and courage. And like, this is something that's, I think, inherently inside of us. And it's the reason why, we love action movies and war movies, all these things, because they, it stirs something up, I think, inside of us, where deep down, we like that as guys. We're wired that way, and we seek after, courage and grit and guts and all that stuff. That's this guy language. And so I love that he has it as the last chapter of this book. And a little kind of fun story I was going to share to jump in as far as the subject goes. And I'd say there's not much courage involved, but maybe some grit. I'd say I'll focus on the grit part here for a minute. But it was actually last Tuesday. So we had our study here on Monday and got home, by the time everything was settled and whatnot. I don't think I got to bed till maybe 11 o'clock. But crazy maniac that I am, I wanted to go deer hunting out of state the next morning. And so last Tuesday morning, I probably woke up, 1:45, something like that in the morning. Slept for about 30, 40 minutes, and got up, packed all my gear, and wanted to go hit Indiana. And so, but I wanted to be sitting in my tree in the back of a swamp, before first light, in another state. And so I got up and packed all my gear, hit the road. My wife's, of course, worried I'm going to die in a fiery car accident, ball of fire, because I haven't slept in, 2 days. And I'm like, oh, it's fine, this stuff's awesome. And so I get down there, drive, managed to drink enough coffee to stay awake and get down there and get into my spot, it's way back in. I'm, sure enough, sitting there 45 minutes before light, hanging and, tired, but I'm like, yeah, this is awesome. It's a cold, frosty morning, and just really pumped up and end up sitting the whole day. Had, my goal was to sit the entire day. I had a few granola bars and, not getting out of my tree. It's the rut. And so I saw a few bucks, had, some deer running around chasing, but not too much going on, and, sat all through the day. I think I took a nap at one point hanging up in my tree. And about an hour before dark, I'm sitting there, and sure enough, here comes just a big old buck is going across the field, and end up, grunting, calling him in, swings in right under me, and gives me a nice 18-yard shot, and I just put one in him, and he goes about 30, 40 yards and piles up, and I'm like, yeah, this is awesome. I'm swinging around up in my tree, hooting and hollering, just having a great old time. And then it hit me that, okay, now I'm by myself out of state, way, way, way back in. I haven't slept in 2 days, and I got to get that thing back to my truck and out of here. And so needless to say, it was exciting, but then once I got down, the real work set in. But a couple hours later, I had that thing, my sled dragged 600-700 yards up, through some stuff and back into my truck, and I was smiling the whole time, because, as guys, that stuff pumps us up. It's like the grit kind of stuff that you're insane out of your mind, but it just like, I'm a man, I'm doing this. And so my wife thinks I'm out of my mind, absolutely. And it got me thinking, about this subject in this chapter, and I'm thinking, that's awesome, but, in a challenging way, God, kind of put it on my heart, that's, you got a lot of grit for that, and, we got to show some of that kind of grit for the kingdom of God, that I'm willing to get up and run myself into the ground chasing, critters around the woods, and again, not in a condemning way, but in a challenging way, I felt like God was putting it on my heart, just like, yeah, I like what you got, but now let's get it pointed this way too, and keep it going. So So I love this subject just because I think it speaks to us as guys. Just, you know, it's something that we naturally have in us. And I think sometimes, you know, again, kind of the guts and grit and courage, we think it's reserved for like the big tough guy, macho guys. You know, you think Navy SEALs and Marines and, you know, big muscly dudes, you know, with that kind of thing. But it's interesting because oftentimes some of the most courageous and, you know, gritty acts like that can be just, I mean, it's just regular guys, regular people. And it's the things of life, I think, that show where you're at. It's one thing to talk about it, to think about it, but your actions actually show what kind of character you have, what kind of courage, guts, and grit you actually have by what you do, right? And so, you know, an example I think of, you know, if you're stuck in a hard marriage, you know, someone that knows, you know, what's going on and God's ultimate plan and is just sticking it out for, you know, seeing a marriage through maybe. I mean, it's, you know, maybe you're married to a, you know, someone who doesn't show you the respect and love, and again, this can go both ways. It could be obviously a lady too, but sticking out a tough situation in life it takes a lot of guts, takes a lot of grit, a lot of determination. Maybe it's completely one-sided. It can be work, it can be family, it can be all sorts of things that just regular guys like us are showing amazing amounts of, you know, steadfastness to be able to stick it out in certain situations. And I think that's really what God's calling us to. It's not necessarily these big superhero moments. It's the everyday sticking it out through stuff and having what it takes. And so the chapter kind of goes on to the main context of what he's getting at is he talks about fear. He talks about stepping out of the cage of fear is, you know, the chapter, what it's about. And I think we all face this in different ways, in different, you know, battles in our life and insecurities and fears, you know, that we all have to wrestle with through life. I mean, it looks different for each of us. There's just different things for different people. But it's a constant thing that's facing us all through life as guys. And I think sometimes, like so many struggles, we get caught up thinking that we're the only ones facing it. We think, you know, I'm the only one who's afraid of this or doesn't have the courage to do this or whatever. Everyone else, I don't know, it seems easy for them. They get it, but, you know, we're over here sometimes isolated. And one of the things I love about men's group and just getting out like we do is that once you get talking to people, you realize, oh, we're all facing the same stuff. It's the same things that come at us every single day since the beginning of time, you know, just faced guys. And one example I have of this that I appreciate so much, and I brought it up before, in group is actually my dad a few years ago, probably now on a Sunday morning. He was talking about fear, and you know me, I look at him. He's obviously he's got it figured out. It seems like, you know, he speaks all the time. I don't think anything would ruffle his feathers and make him nervous. But I remember it was on a Sunday morning. He was talking about how sometimes he still gets nervous, insecure, afraid, like, you know, speaking or in some engagement or conference or whatever it might be. And that really blew my mind because I'm thinking, like, really? Like, I know I'm over here with all that, but, like, I didn't realize, you know, other people struggle, especially someone who's been doing it all their life or for a really long time. And it really, it's helpful when we start learning this because you realize, like, oh, we're all in this together. And something he said that I think of all the time was he said, just do it scared. That's something that goes through his mind. And that's guts and grit, really, if you think about it. You know, he's scared, but you're doing it anyway. That's courage. That's toughness. And he said a lot of times in life, you might be in a situation and you just got to do it scared because you know it's right. You know it's the thing to do. And it's not about feeling all secure and courageous all the time. Sometimes you just got to do something because it's right. And even if you got to do it afraid. And so that's really helped me just hear that from other people that you would just never expect it from, that we all face this. And so we have to decide, really, do we stay in the cage of fear or do we step out? That's kind of the big idea that we're talking about. There's these different things we face, and we have decisions to make, to stay or to walk out. And I think at the end of the day, what he's talking about with, like, guts and grit and courage, I think it's produced by stepping out of the cage of fear. I think that follows that. It's not the other way around. And so we might ask, okay, that sounds great. How do I do that? You know, can't just flip a switch and not be, you know, afraid of stuff anymore. You know, it's how do you step out of the cage of fear. And there's a lot of helpful stuff that we've been studying in the chapter, but I want to kind of unpack it a little bit more. And the Bible talks a lot about do not fear. It's all through the Bible. There's tons and tons of verses, and I want to read just a couple real quick. First one is Psalm 23:4, and this is one that a lot of people here probably know. It says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. Psalm 27:1 says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And then Psalm 56:4 says, in God whose words I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me? And then jumping into the New Testament, we have Romans 8:14-16 takes it a little further. It says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And I love that, because what it's unpacking and saying there is, in Christ, we have a new spirit, not of fear, not of our old enslaved nature. Our old nature before Christ was enslaved to fear. We are free from the spirit of fear in the name of Jesus in Christ. Our new identity in him gives us a road out of that, and he has victory over that. And so one thing that's you kind of see through these verses, and if you spend some time just going through the different verses on not being afraid in the Bible, you see a theme of trust. And I believe the answer to breaking through fear in our lives comes from trust. It comes from trusting God. And I want to kind of read a couple more verses that hit on this. The next one is Jeremiah 17:7-8. It says, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. And then Psalm 53:3 says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. And I think the answer to fear is developing a full and a complete trust in our God. And that's what it is. That's what breaks fear off of our lives. Trusting that he is our source. Trusting he will provide. Trusting if we mess up, he loves us. His grace covers us. Trust our lives hold value. Even if we should die, it is not wasted and he is in control. Trusting God that much, even through to the point of death. Trusting that if we go through anything, no matter how difficult or dark, he is there with us and we are not alone. Trusting that if we step out, he will meet us there and we will not be abandoned. And trusting that he is just faithful. And trusting God is just the offset of fear. Fear comes from insecurity and all these other things. And when we trust in our God, it buries fear. Our first inclination, I think what this comes from too, is it's kind of a lot of times our first inclination is to rely on ourselves, especially as guys. We like to fix stuff, take care of stuff, be our own guys. I think it's kind of a thing that can come at us as men. And I think we get this mentality of like I can do it myself, I can make it happen, I can take care of myself, I can gather everything around me I need. And when we rely on ourselves through life's either experience or wounds maybe in life, we put up walls around ourselves. And I think what this does is we might have a giant wall around ourselves, but the gate is wide open for fear to come and attack us. And what often happens is that stifles the guts and the grit that we're talking about in this book and in the Word of God. And how it does that is because we can only control what we can control on our own. We live inward. We put up walls around us to limit risk and to stay safe in our own minds. When we're relying on me, I can't afford to take risks. When we're talking about living with guts and grit for the kingdom of God, in my world, I can't afford that, because what if it doesn't pan out? What if I take this step and it doesn't work? What if I go over here and this happens or this person does? When we're in our own kingdom and our own master, so to speak, we we have to put a guard around ourselves, and it really limits kind of the guts and grit and just go for it attitude that we're talking about. And because it involves risk, but when we trust our God that He is going to be there, He's our source, and we can rely on Him, it offsets that. And so, what are some of the ways that we build trust? It's kind of my next point I want to get into. So, kind of talking about, okay, fear is a thing. We trust God. That can, that can break fear off of us. But what are some ways that we can build trust in our lives is something I want to get to next. And I believe it comes through taking action and taking steps of faith. And I'm going to play in just a second a video clip that this is kind of funny because I hadn't watched this movie. It's probably been 10 years. And it just popped in my head when I was putting this together. And I was thinking, oh, that's perfect. And it's not doctrine. It's not theology. So don't send me an email. Most of you guys will know the movie right away. But I think it really sums up kind of my next point I want to talk to a little bit. So.
Impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Indy, you must hurry. Come quickly.
It's a leap of faith.
You must believe, boy. You must believe.
I love that. That popped in my head, and I was like, oh, yeah, that sums it up right there. And when I was thinking about that, I watched that clip, I thought, why is it God always does that? Like, that was the first thought I had. I was thinking, why doesn't He just show us the path? That, I mean, it's funny that just, a movie that obviously isn't like, a Christian movie, like, can have such a wonderful illustration, because I was just thinking, like, I love you, Lord. I want to serve you. I'll go where you want me to go. Just show me the road, and I'll start walking. And I'm like, why does he never does that? He makes us always take that first step into just the invisible no man's land. And I'll be honest, a lot of times you got to change your pants after it, because it's like why? I was literally like thinking, like, why, Lord? Why do you do that? And I chewed on it a little bit, I was thinking it builds trust, it builds reliance on Him. If it was easy, the path was clear. I mean, those are just directions, really. When we have to take big steps and, put ourselves out there and just trust that there's a path underneath us, it takes a lot. It takes a lot of trust, and it builds a lot when God comes through like He does. And so we need to get to the point where if He doesn't show up, we're not going to make it. That's kind of like what that clip was doing. If that path wasn't there, He's just gone. And as men, I think we need to live that way, where we're taking steps where if God don't show up, we're toast. We need to be so sold out for Him that's it. It's the only option. And when we trust in our God, nothing can touch us. Fear falls off because we know our God has our back. That's the big thing. I think He said that in the chapter. When we know God has our back, we live differently. When I know He's going to come through, when I know that He's there, I live differently, I walk differently, I make different decisions. And so that's where the guts and the grit come from. You break through that, and then all of a sudden, okay, I got the courage, I got the guts, I got the grit, because I know God's there, and He's going to be faithful, and He's got my back, and I can do this. And so But it takes those leaps of faith and those steps of faith in different areas of our lives. And so there's another story I kind of wanted to, that I thought of when I was putting this together that really illustrated this, I thought. And it's a World War II era story as well, which, funny enough, I think that movie is from World War II era. And so that must be the theme, I guess, that's going around my head right now. But there's a story that I love because it's just basically impossibly crazy. Like, you know, as guys, we love stories that are so far out there, true stories. We love when there's a story that's true, that's just insane and crazy and basically impossible. If you're anything like me, I love hearing stuff like that. And there's a story that probably a lot of you in here know from either there was a movie made about it or even just maybe know the story, but it's impossibly crazy. And it's about a combat medic in World War II named Desmond Doss. And it was the Battle of Okinawa, and the battle was Hacksaw Ridge, if you've seen the movie. And this story blows my mind, and I was thinking about it a couple days ago. Again, it just popped in my mind. And what this guy was he was a regular guy. He wasn't some big macho, you know, superhero type. He was actually kind of a skinny little, you know, I can relate to him. You know, he's a thin little dude like me, maybe a little shorter, but He went through quite a, if you see the movie or know his back trail, he had a pretty rough life, went through a lot of stuff, and he didn't want to carry a gun because of a lot of stuff that happened in his past, and he got really ostracized and scrutinized for this because he was called a conscientious objector, or conscientious objector, something like that, but it's basically someone who doesn't carry a gun in the war, and back then especially, I mean, he really went through the ringer with people because they thought he's a wimp, he's a coward, he doesn't want to fight, you know, like that's where people are going with him. And things changed when the bullets started flying with this guy, because as history shows, it wasn't a lack of courage that was motivating him, it was some other things. And in the Battle of Hacksaw Ridge, or that was the name of the front line they were up against, they had to climb up this sheer cliff and then go right at a bunch of machine gun nests, and it was a massacre. It was a terrible battle with a heavy, heavy, huge cost, and they pulled back, they retreated, but he didn't. He stayed up there. They actually went over the ridge and were gone. He stayed up there and started dragging guys back, and unbelievably crazy story. He ended up saving, it's funny because I like the guy because he's humble too. When they asked him about it, he said he thought he saved about 50 guys. Everyone else said, I think it was 100. So they split the difference to 75 is kind of where they landed at the number. But he saved 75 men, dragged them out of just hellacious conditions under fire, you know, just enemy troops everywhere, one at a time, lowered them over the cliff. And it's insane. It's miraculous that he wasn't killed or discovered, or, you know, just unbelievably insane. And what jumps out about his story is when he was interviewed about it, he says that every time he brought a man back, he would pray, Lord, just one more. And that really stuck out to me because he believed in God, and he was a man of faith, and he was doing this not because he was a superhero, not because he, you know, was trained in it or whatever. He believed in what he was doing. He believed it was right. And he believed God had his back, live or die. Like, I don't think I bet you didn't expect it to get out of that situation, but his prayer of just one more was, Lord, keep me alive, to get at least one more. And that really struck me, because I'm just thinking, like, wow, what an amazing example for how we need to live as guys. I mean, this guy's charge was just one more, Lord. Help me get just one more. And he was just committed. He was all in. And I believe that is just where we need to live and where we need to wake up every day as men. Every day matters. Every person matters. Every situation matters. We're not just meaninglessly walking along through life. God's given us tools and ability, and he's equipped us, and we have the ability to step into the war zone that's going on around us in this world and go after men and women and people for the kingdom of God, and just live with this mentality of just one more, Lord. Who can I influence today? Who can I shed light, you know, on? Who can I bring your truth to? Like, you know, where are those opportunities? And just believe and know that God has our back and that he is with us, because he is. And so I want to close kind of this evening with one final challenge to us. And honestly, and it's what we've been talking about this whole series, and it's, I want to challenge us to stop seeking really safety and security in the sense that we maybe normally do, And there's nothing wrong with obviously praying and asking for a covering and favor and security around us. That's not what I'm talking about, but seeking out just safety and security and how we walk out our lives. But let's start praying dangerous prayers. Let's start putting ourselves out there, taking steps that look like we're about to step off an edge that if God don't show up, something, you know, we're in trouble. And just risk and getting out there. And I wrote in my notes that I think that the risk of staying in these cages is far greater than the risk of stepping out of them. That's sometimes we think that I can't, you know, I'm going to stay right here because it's safe. I think as men, it's way more dangerous to stay where we're at than to charge forward and plow forward. And so I really want to challenge us just to say yes to everything God puts in front of you and me this season, no matter how big, how scary, just say yes to all of it. Like, let's just, you know, just go for it and take that first step and trust that he will make the path appear under our feet and that he'll have our back. And so, yeah, I think it'll be awesome. We'll see what he does, you know, with us as men. And just, I mean, the amount of guys right here, I mean, we could really mess stuff up for the kingdom of God, I think. So it's that's kind of my final charge and closing thought to us. And I'll pray for us a minute. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. Thank you for what you put in us, Lord. You put the heart of lions in us, Lord, and courage and strength and all that comes from you, Lord. And we just pray for that over this group, over each one of us, Lord. Help us just to have passion and courage and just the drive, Lord, to just step out and go after the things around us, Lord, and just the people in our lives, Lord, our families, co-workers, and just people on the street, everywhere we go, Lord. We just pray that we would just be men of conviction and integrity and just men of light, Lord, that shine you and your truth everywhere we go. Help us to step dangerously into places, Lord, that other people don't dare to go, Lord, and just go for one more, drag one more person out, Lord, and just live that way with the all-in mentality. We just pray for that ability, Lord. We pray every action, every step we take glorifies you, honors you. We ask for just an anointing, an ability, and an equipping, Lord, as men, just to do your work and to be your hands and feet in this earth. And just may you go before us, Lord. Pray for favor and blessing over the families represented here, over the church, Lord. May it just shine brightly and just glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.